On behalf of the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering, and also the John A. Bloom Earthquake Engineering Center, welcome you all here tonight. I'm glad you all found the lecture room area down here. It's a real pleasure. This is an annual lecture we have, part of a lecture series. I'd like to begin by just acknowledging the support we have this from the Shaw family. Their generosity is described a little bit in this brochure, setting up an endowment that helps Stanford and the students and the university in many ways. But one of the ways is by funding this lecture series. Specifically, I'm looking at catastrophic risk. And I always use this introduction to help reacquaint some of our current students with a little bit about kind of the history of our department. And Professor Shaw is emeritus now, is an important part of that, being on the faculty for many years, being department chairman, being a co-founding director of the Bloom Earthquake Engineering Research Center. And really, a lot of his research over the years focused on loss modeling, looking at questions of catastrophic risk, and a few of his former students he kind of inspired to create a company, one of those students being his son, called Risk Management Solutions, that took a lot of that research and put it into practice and really continues to kind of transform the way that risks we look at in natural hazards and even other hazards now are to take that kind of technology into practice. So really appreciate that support. Raise your hand so our current students can see you. So you're not just some name on the board up there. So it's a real pleasure to introduce our speaker tonight, Charles Scawthorne, to fly all the way here from Kyoto to give this lecture. Really delighted he could do that. He and I had to kind of figure out a time to give this lecture between times when I was in town, other folks, the rest was in town, and that he wasn't teaching lectures back in Kyoto. Charlie is a professor of lifeline engineering at Kyoto University. He's a structural engineer like many of us by background. I think really what distinguishes him though is that he was one of the early pioneers in structural engineering, I think, who began to look at, when we look at the safety of buildings and we design buildings under earthquake, to describe it in terms of risk and ways to describe that to owners. And you start to look at the risk of a building, then you start to look around at risk and what can happen to the infrastructure due to catastrophic events. Such as earthquakes, and he really kind of pioneered that, kind of the practice and the development of that, going to look at infrastructures, also other kind of risks. Fire following earthquake is an area where he's made kind of many contributions, in addition to taking models for risk under earthquakes, extreme events, and carrying that over to looking at flood risks. And indeed, many of his models have been used by government agencies in this program called HAZUS to look at risks under flood, have been many of Charlie's contributions. He's at the university now, but I think his career, he's kind of straddled between being in industry and also being at the university. And I think from the work I knew of him in industry, he was very much like a faculty researcher there. I think he did his consulting work, but he also really pushed the state of the art on any occasion that he did. And has kind of 30 years in that, a number of the years, and some years ago when I first met him at firm EQE across the bay that did some of this kind of risk modeling. But over the years, he's developed models. He's consulted with many multinational corporations that are interested in their risk, insurance companies, government agencies working for FEMA, both here, World Bank here, and around the world, and really kind of helped transform, I think, in many of the ways that Rest Shah's work also did, kind of the way that people view this special kind of risk due to catastrophic events. So it's kind of with that introduction, I know Charlie has plenty to say. I'd like to just welcome him here tonight, and again, really appreciate him making this trip here.
So. Well, thank you very much, Greg. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's really my honor and pleasure to be here today, and Professor Shaw, and Mr. Chairman, Chief Parker, and ladies and gentlemen, distinguished visitors. I'm very, honored and pleased to be able to share with you my thoughts today on catastrophic risk. The outline of what I'm going to be talking about is shown here. I'm basically going to, for a moment, discuss the question of what do we mean by catastrophe, and then I'm going to talk. Go back, the past is always a prelude to the future, so, and I think it's the future that most of us really care about. So, but to understand where we may be going, we need to look at where we've come from. So I'm going to talk about the development of the ways we've looked at cat risk and analyzed going to talk about the current status for a moment, and then talk about future cats. As we all know, cats are the jargon for catastrophes. Now, for some, catastrophes are earthquakes, floods, hurricanes, and similar acts of God. And examples are the 1871 Chicago fire, 1900 Galveston hurricane, or 1906 San Francisco earthquake and fire. Now, if we look at the San Francisco earthquake and fire, of course, it was one of the great earthquakes and one of the great faults. However, most of the 80% of the damage actually, of course, was due to the fire and not to the earthquake. And given the prelude to that event, the 1871 Chicago fire and the 1904 Baltimore fire, which you may not be familiar with, which burnt downtown Baltimore two years before the San Francisco earthquake and fire, and many other fires in the United States. And the fact that San Francisco in 1905 was an all-wood city. The fact that the National Board of Fire Underwriters in 1905 could come to San Francisco and say, as is written there, the fact that the city has not burned down yet has violated all underwriting traditions and precedent, and that it has not done so is largely due to the vigilance of the fire department, which cannot be relied upon indefinitely to stay in the inevitable. So the fire here was hardly a surprise. And given that background here, the 1991 East Bay Hills fire, for example, or most recently, fires that we've had in Southern California just weeks ago, and this photograph's courtesy of Chief Vic Sudia, are hardly a surprise either. And indeed, these analyses, for example, this analysis done 20 years ago to look at catastrophic fire risk in San Francisco and Los Angeles shows that not only in 1905, but today, these kinds of risks are quite well understood. So when we talk about catastrophes or disasters, what exactly is it that we're talking about? What do we mean? Well, if we don't ask about the meaning of a word, we run to the dictionary, and we look at catastrophes, first used in 1540. And it's a reversal of what is expected, especially a fatal turning point, has references to Greek drama. It was first used only about 200 years ago as synonymous, or 250 years ago as synonymous with disaster. And then even more recently, geologically, there's a geologic term, catastrophism is a geological biological term. If we look at those, we can see that catastrophism is this upheaval in a political or social as well as a geologic sense. And a cataclysm, which is also related to it, is a violent upheaval, and so on. So catastrophe really means a turning downward. And as opposed to disaster, which basically comes, has a similar etymology, but basically comes from a misalignment of the stars. Disaster literally means dis, meaning negative, and aster, I've been saying there's astrology, so it's negative or bad alignment of the stars. And I'm going to come back to this distinction later between these two words. Now, if we want to talk about catastrophes, this painting here may give you, may have the appearances of a catastrophe with people dying on the ground and angels overhead and so on. And I'm going to draw my examples in the next few minutes from the earthquake field, because it's a field I know well, many of us know well. And the Bloom Center is sponsoring this, so talking about the development of cat risk analysis in the context of earthquakes is something we can all relate to. And if you want to talk about the catastrophic earthquakes, in modern civilization, probably the 1755 Lisbon earthquake, where this painting comes from, is the first modern catastrophic earthquake. It was felt across Europe. Buildings collapsed, many fires, a massive tsunami, people felt like it was the end of the world. Caused the massive destruction of Lisbon. Lisbon at the time was the capital of the Portuguese Empire, which had been the dominant empire of Western Europe and the first explorations. It sort of occupied a position in Europe at that time that perhaps Paris occupies in our mind today. It was the center, one of the centers of the largest, most beautiful cities in Europe, central culture and learning. It was all destroyed. 60,000 people were killed.
and it occurred on November the 1st, All Saints Day. So it had very profound impacts. Again, felt across Europe, occurred on a holy day, killed all these people, and it profoundly affected Western civilization, actually. Candide, Voltaire wrote Candide. Voltaire was deeply depressed over this event. Immanuel Kant was also. And Voltaire really questioned God, why would you do this? And his frustration and uncertainties turned into anger, which was translated into the ridicule and satire of Candide, where this is this the best of all possible worlds? He also, this is one of the monuments that still exists in Lisbon today, he also wrote a poem on this event, the poem on the disaster of Lisbon. And it goes in part, did Lisbon, which is no more, have more vices than London and Paris immersed in their pleasures? Lisbon is destroyed and they dance in Paris. He was very, again, profoundly disturbed by this. Rousseau, on the other hand, his contemporary, his friend, disagreed. And in correspondence, Rousseau responded, Wait, it wasn't nature that collected 20,000 people and houses on the site, but the inhabitants of this big city had been more equally dispersed and more lightly housed, the damage would have been much less. Rousseau responded very rationally. Rousseau had a hidden agenda here also, of course. He was promoting, he was anti-city and was promoting the natural way of life. But he had a very rational, unemotional analysis of the situation. And this, the response here just shows sort of the cusp of going of the Enlightenment, the beginning of the Enlightenment, and also the Industrial Revolution, the rational analysis here. So what I'd like to do then is start with that point, start at that moment in time, and then briefly trace first where we've come from or how we've gotten here in terms of catastrophic risk analysis. Now, I'm not going to go through every point on all of these tables. These tables are taken from a larger chapter I wrote on the history of seismic risk assessment. But I'm going to highlight certain points here. And the table is a chronological table, and it's divided into several parts, as you'll see. Generally speaking, hazard is over on the left. The developments, the historical developments that deal with hazard are over on the left. In the middle is vulnerability, exposure, and then the convolution of those, of course, is risk, and that comes over here. And then to the extent that there were sort of extraneous events, they may be noted on the right. And after the Lisbon earthquake, really the next development in terms of seismology and so on, actually to go back to Lisbon for a moment, Lisbon is often cited as the beginning of seismology and the Lisbon event and reaction to it, and the beginning of seismology and the beginning of aseismic construction. But it really wasn't in a sense. They did do, Prime Minister did send out a questionnaire and they did collect isoseismal information and they did put in aseismic construction measures in the building code in Lisbon. But these never disseminated or promulgated outside of Portugal and had really no influence. Whereas the first person to really have much influence at all was Robert Mallet. Mallet was an Irish engineer. He got into an interest that used blasting. He did mining and geology. And from that he got very interested in ground motion. And from that, he then became very interested in earthquakes. And Mallet collected a lot of seismic experience and data and drew these maps you see up on the right here. This was basically his 1848 map of seismic risk for the world. And if you compare that against the GSHAP map made a few years ago, or the Global Patterns of Seismicity. For 1848, it was remarkably accurate. Now, that was the first development on the hazard side. On the exposure side, because the risk has three parts of vulnerability and so on, about the same time, actually a little after the Civil War in the United States, was the development of insurance maps. And the Sanborn maps are the most famous example of these. They were developed contemporaneously both in England States, and they were for underwriting, for fire underwriting purposes, they went through and they mapped each city and actually each building. And each building, and you can see here individual buildings, color-coded by materials of construction. Red is masonry, and then the
show the fire protective features, the windows, and so on. But both of these were independent developments and were not linked together. And while Mallet had mapped the seismic risk exposure, that was very qualitative and there was no way to really go about measuring it. And the first really birth of seismology began both in Germany and Italy with some developments of instrumentation, but really, in a sense, I think had its best birth, so to speak, in Japan, strangely enough, because it was Milne, Ewing, and some other geological engineers who went to Japan, were brought in by the Japanese government as part of the modernization of Japan in 1880, and only a few weeks after they arrived in Yokohama experienced an earthquake. And particularly for Milne, but for all of them, that earthquake really grabbed their attention, and they literally dropped their plans that they had come to Japan to teach geology and so on, and immediately became interested in trying to measure earthquakes. And Ewing developed the first seismometer, and Milne began using it to record instruments, to record events. He recorded those events for the next 50 years. After he lived in Japan for about 30 years, then went back to England, became basically the grand old man of seismology. They founded the Seismological Society of Japan, the first seismological society in the world. It was founded about 20 years before SSA here in the United States, and so on. So this was really the beginning of the efforts to start measuring earthquakes. At the same time, in Italy, Mercalli, this is Mercalli here, Giuseppe Mercalli, and Rossi and Farrell about the same time, without instruments, were using isoseismal information, collecting damage data, developing the scale of damage, and using that to map earthquakes. In 1891, there was a great earthquake in Nobi, Japan, and this shows the fault crossing the field here. And this is Professor Omori. As a result of this earthquake, the Japanese government created the Imperial Seismological Commission, or committee, and they Omori was a student of Milne's, and basically, after a few years, Ewing and the others all returned to Britain, with the exception of Milne, who had married a Japanese. And Omori and Imamura and others took over and really started to develop seismology. And they did fundamental studies at the time, developed the JMA scale, which was rationally based as opposed to the Mercalli scale, related back to physics, the peak ground acceleration, and so on. We'll come back to Omori in a few minutes. The next event that really influenced the development of seismic risk analysis was the San Francisco earthquake and fire. The fundamental contribution in that regard was Hugo Reed's development of the elastic rebound theory, which for the first time started to explain really what was causing earthquakes. Wegener, at the same time, propounded the origin of continents and oceans, or continental drift. But as I think we all know, the plate tectonics, this was basically the same thing as plate tectonics. He was ridiculed at the time, and plate tectonics had to wait another 50 years to be developed. In the 1920s, Hale brought first Charles Richter and Harry Anderson, Harry Wood, excuse me, and Anderson, who was at the Hale Observatory, to Caltech, and they developed the Wood-Anderson seismometer, which they started to deploy. Bruno Gutenberg was brought in shortly later, and after a few years, they had enough data that Charles Richter started to try to analyze it. Richter joined the lab, the seismic lab down there in 1925, as we all know, Richter, in trying to read or understand this data and make some sense of it, came up with the idea of using the log of the amplitude of the maximum amplitude of the trace as a measure of magnitude. He borrowed the term magnitude from astrology and developed the Richter magnitude scale. And with that, then, we were able for the first time to start having a common measure for the size of earthquakes, which then we could start then trying to develop some sort of a pattern to those earthquakes. In another area, Frank Knight, at the same time in the 1920s, published the book Risk, Uncertainty, and Profit, which is well known in the economics field and class in risk management. And Knight's definitions of risk and uncertainty we now would today call aleatory and epistemic uncertainty. But this book here basically laid the foundation for risk management of all kinds, which are the ideas that we will see later developing. The Tokyo earthquake and fire was where Omura comes back in. Imamura, about 10 years before the Tokyo earthquake, before 1923, had looked at the patterns of seismicity and had realized that the basically recurrence period of seismic gap was such that there was going to be a large earthquake in Tokyo. Omori, on the other hand, wanted to not alarm the public and tended to downplay that. So this resulted in a constant tension here. But when the Tokyo earthquake did occur, several of the Japanese engineers, such as Naito and their buildings, who had developed the concept of the equivalent lateral force for design of buildings, showed that their buildings could be designed properly. And then in 1925, the Santa Barbara earthquake occurred, which led to the first promulgation of a building code in the United States. And a figure, John Freeman, we'll see in a moment, because of this became very interesting. And Freeman and others went over to Tokyo for the first World Engineering Conference in the late 20s, where they met Suya Hiro, who brought back the United States. This is Freeman here. Freeman, they attended the World Conference in 1929. Freeman realized that Freeman was a remarkable guy. He founded the Factory Mutual System, was the only person who's been president both of the American Society of Civil Engineers and the American Society of Mechanical Engineers. And Freeman realized that these people in the earthquake field, they're measuring earthquakes thousands of miles away. And yet, the earthquakes that are happening in their backyards, the engineers who are trying to design for those have no measure of what they're trying to design against. So Freeman realized that we needed a strong motion seismometer. He went and had went basically spoke to President Hoover and got this approved. The U.S. Coastal Geodetic Survey developed it in 1930 and 31. It was deployed in 32, and in March of 33, the first strong motion recordings were made in Long Beach. Before the Japanese. And it was this, the Japanese from the Nobu earthquake 1891 through to the Tokyo earthquake 1923 were basically the world's leaders in seismic design and in seismological investigations. But the founding by Hale of the Caltech Observatory, bringing in Gutenberg, Richter, Wood, and so on, combined, and then later with these strong motion observations there, basically allowed the U.S. to go beyond that. They also, this is a photograph here that shows Martel, Suyohiro, Gutenberg, and Anderson. And Freeman paid to have Suyohiro come over, and he gave four lectures at MIT, Berkeley, Stanford, and Caltech. And his lectures were bound and published in the United States, and they were basically regarded as the most advanced things in the world. This is Richter. The next thing that happens then, World War II intervenes, and of course there are some distractions there. But Gutenberg and Richter were basically doing the same thing that Mallet had done earlier, of going through and looking at the seismicity of the Earth. Having the ability to basically assign a size to an earthquake, in this case the magnitude, they then could then eventually develop the Gutenberg-Richter magnitude frequency relationship. Point of that being now, with that, they could use that to estimate the probability of an event occurring. the, independently of that, in Japan, Kawasumi developed, using basically the same concepts, developed this probability map of for Japan. This is developed in 1951, and this is the comparable map that was developed, that was being used in the US at the time. This is based entirely on historic seismicity. In other words, these are just historic events, and based on that, they drew some circles around where historic events have occurred. This is a completely probabilistic analysis. And as I'll show you a little later, the this comparable level of analysis was not achieved in the United States for more than 20 years. Hauser then made several contributions at that time, which I'll just glance over in the interest of time. In the 1960s, we had the emergence of plate tectonics. So that what was coming together then was, with plate tectonics, an understanding of the fundamental causes of what earthquakes, why earthquakes were occurring. With the magnitude-frequency relationship, we could then assign probability to each location where they were occurring. Hauser's point of Hauser's being here was the development of the first attenuation equations. And so therefore, you could then go and, given an event, you could determine the hazard effects at that point. With the Sanborn maps, if you wanted to, you had the information for building inventory at that point and so on. So all the pieces were there to do a risk analysis. However, and actually Bailey Willis at Stanford in the 1920s had laid out this program also, but the risk analysis would not yet be done. Rather, from left field, Don Friedman came in the Travelers Company. He'd been at MIT and moved to the Travelers Company, and he developed the same, basically the exact same framework for analyzing hurricane risk in the eastern United States for the insurance companies there. And these were the first risk natural hazards risk analyses that were being, not hazard analysis, but risk analyses that were being performed there. At the same time, Quarantelli and Dines founded the Disaster Research Center, first at Ohio State, and then moved it, this is Quarantelli and Dines, moved it to University of Delaware. The 60s then, over here, the Army Corps of Engineers, because of the floods that were occurring, developed the same framework that Friedman was using for flood analysis. And then in 1968, Steinberg, he wrote fundamentally profound work, The Earthquake Hazard in the Bay Area, Continuing Problem, where he basically, for the first time, said, we have a major earthquake problem here, and this is a program by which it could be reduced, and we need to go ahead and start doing the analysis. The one thing that was missing that would tie all this together was the ability to integrate all of these pieces together. And this is Steinberg here. And gentleman in the audience, Alan Cornell, wrote the seminal paper that, that profoundly influenced, I think, most of us, especially myself, that clearly laid out, it was called engineering seismic risk, although it was, in today's parlance, we would call it a hazard analysis, but it laid out the way to integrate the fault, the attenuation, the magnitude-frequency relationships, and so on, so that you could do a hazard analysis, and the extension of from that by combining the vulnerability was readily apparent to people who read the paper. And this was a fundamental paradigm shift and introduced probabilistic thinking in a rational way into the earthquake field. It's interesting now to compare where we were at this moment. This is the 1960s and so on. This is Cornell's paper right here, 1968. And this blue line shows the growth of U.S. nuclear power, and the number of plants that would operate, number of units. And you can see that at this point, very few plants, had been built at that point. But that very quickly thereafter, almost all the plants had been built. And the translation of Cornell's method, which was the WASH 1400 report, laid out a way to do basically a complete analysis of risk for the Rasmussen report, WASH 1400, in the mid-70s. But by that point, most of these plants had been designed, so that many of our nuclear power plants are, in a sense, very sizable, obsolete. San Fernando earthquake occurred then, and 1971, and the number of
earthquake recordings in the world at that point jumped from 741 to 1758 at that time. Another thing that came out of Martin Duke recognized the impacts on infrastructure. They called the lifelines at that time. So it was the birth of lifeline earthquake engineering. And very soon thereafter, Algernon, Steinbrugge, Ligorio, and others produced a study of the earthquake losses in the San Francisco Bay Area, the study that Steinbrugge called for in 68. These studies were replicated in other cities across the United States after that. So we start to see an acceleration now of seismic risk analysis. Whitman started the program of seismic design decision analysis in MIT in 73. This went through 77. Professor Cornell was one of many contributors to that. Wiggins, PTAC, and others were funded by NSF to look at multi-hazards, earthquake, flood, wind across the United States. The Washington 100 report comes out. And in 1976, we get the probabilistic hazard map of the United States by Algernon. This is the cover of the Washington 100 report. This shows the growth of strong motion instruments from the first recording in 1933 through, and you can see here, the cumulative number of strong motion records. And this graph here shows the maximum recording. So with the growth of instruments, of course, the maximum recording goes up also. And today we have, at this point, I think I stopped counting, about 50,000 here. There's over 100,000 earthquake strong motion recordings today. These are some of the reports that came out of the MIT seismic hazard, a seismic design decision analysis program, a very comprehensive program. This shows the 1970, recall Kawasumi's map from 1951. This is the 1973 UBC map of the United States, and you can see the amount of detail in California. But Cornell's method, which not yet been translated into the UBC, by 1976, Algernon was able to identify all these seismic sources, and basically the change was a watershed from 73 to 76 of our understanding of the hazard we faced and therefore the risk we faced. So in the 70s and 80s then, risk analysis progressed. And there were a number of different people contributing to this, Steinbrugge and others at Civil Fire Rating Bureau, Wiggins, PTAC, at Stanford University here was one of the leaders, on the leadership of Professor Shaw and others. This was one of the reports, this is Boissonnot's PhD thesis on insurance, earthquake insurance, supervised by Professor Shaw. The ATC 13 report was the first compilation of vulnerability functions. It was worked on fire, falling, earthquake, and all of this could be then integrated, for example, into National Lifeline Seismic Vulnerability Analysis. So we see this development from Mallet in 1848, basically qualitatively laying out. I'll come back to that point in a minute. About in 78 then, one of Cornell's students, Rob McGuire, published the FRISC program at the USGS, which is a public domain program. Became the core of, it was a program that performed the complex calculations that Cornell had laid out, and it allowed this then to be developed anywhere, it could be used anywhere. Literally, this program has been used around the world and is the heart of many programs to the present day. This is the ATC 13 again. The IRIS model then was developed here at Stanford, and then most recently the hazards analysis started to be developed here in the early 90s. So what we see is, in this quick review of 150 years of history, and I've left out many things, and not done justice to some of the things I did mention, we see that catastrophic risk analysis fundamentally consists of these three parts, but each of these, of course, are contributed to by many different disciplines. For example, by putting these through a risk and so on, we can come up with a loss exceedance curve or the probability of the various kinds of losses, which then can be put into the kind of framework that Knight had laid out of cost-benefit analysis and rational decision-making, economic decision-making. This also shows the same process. These are your assets at risk. This line here is a source. It can either be an earthquake, hurricane, or a flash flood. But that source, the framework is the same, whether it's for earthquakes. I've reviewed the earthquake history, and I've alluded a little bit to hurricanes and flooding. The mapping and the analysis is very much the same. You take this frequency severity relationship, basically the hazard curve, the attenuation equation here. These two combined give you then your hazard curve for a site. This is your maximum frequency relationship. So, you take your vulnerability curve, you integrate them through this equation. And Professor Shaw and others have written programs to do this. And eventually, then you can come up with your loss exceedance curve. Now, if we have, today we're all concerned about climate. This is under current conditions. Today we're all concerned about climate change. With climate change, basically that may add more events or changes the magnitude frequency relationship of these events. And basically the same framework can be used there just to take into account the effects of climate change or whatever. All of these processes, again, sort of came together in late 80s, early 90s. The IRIS program was one. HAZES a few years later followed that. The first real-time application of this was in the 1994 earthquake. Earthquake occurred about 5 o'clock in the morning. At AQE, we generated this map by about 11 a.m., about 6 hours after the event. And this was used by Governor Wilson at the time to negotiate with President Clinton to estimate the losses. The state damage estimate was based on a computer model. So all of this by this point had developed. All these threads had come together. Now, while it was based on a computer model, there was still a lot of improvement to be done. This is an article I published about a year and a half later. And it made the point that I looked at what had been estimated versus what had been reported. And while we did a pretty good job of estimating the overall damage, the insurance losses were woefully wrong. These were estimates published by the different companies at the time. These estimates were produced within 1 or 2 days, with one exception. PCS all of these are basically modeling technology based on models. This is based on the extrapolation of claims at the time. PCS stands for the Property Casualty Service of the Insurance Industry. And you can see the estimates here were very lowly, well, $1 to $2 billion, basically, in loss estimates, published a day or two after giving modeling. There's a point I want to make here. maybe I can just pull away from it for a second. You can read here. These estimates were made within a day or two after the earthquake. On February the 7th in 1994, the estimates had gone, the PCS estimates had gone from 2.5 in April to 4.5 in June to 5.5 in August to 7 in January, about 5 years later, to 10 billion. Basically, all of the modeling companies, this probabilistic risk analysis, were all wrong by a huge factor. And what were the reasons for that? They're listed in the yellow box. They were basically, while the damage was reasonably well estimated, the insurance losses were way, way low. And why? Because of underinsurance, basically because of poor information and on the insurance aspects and the neglecting of many uncertainties on the insurance side of the equation. Since that time, a lot of work has been done to improve this modeling. The COVID earthquake came along, HAZES had its initial release then. And what we see then, to go back now, MALID has the founding of seismology about 1850, MILM as the development of the first practical seismograph, founding of the Seismological Society of Japan, elastic rebound theory, Wegener's continental drift, Freeman encourages strong motion program, Caltech has developed the magnitude scale, magnitude frequency relationship, response spectra, Cornell's paper on engineering seismic risk or hazard analysis. Finite element method allows vulnerability analysis. Steinbrugge and so on. start to produce the first loss estimates. Wiggins, another one. Whitman's, people at MIT are basically laying a more solid foundation, a consistent approach for all of this. ATC 13 brings in a set of vulnerability functions that are easily applicable. They don't require a finite element analysis of the structure. We have the rise of, in the insurance industry, interest in the modelers in the 90s, and development of software, hazards, and so on from the 90s to now. And this is basically the start of development of risk analysis in different threads. And what really, the development is really first the compilation of the data, then development of measures to analyze the data, integrate the data, and to model it. So that's how we've gotten to where we are. Now, where are we? Well, right now the U.S. has been the center of innovation in catastrophe risk analysis and almost the only center of application, although that's rapidly changing, as we'll see in a moment. The global insurance industry is served by the various modelers. HAZUS is an extensive technology that models these three floods. But now there's a European equivalent of HAZUS that's being developed, less loss. CATS has been developed here. This is HAZUS Taiwan. This is in the Philippines. This is RADIUS, which is developed by the United Nations for use around the world. This is another program in the United States. This is a Russian equivalent to HAZUS, quake loss for earthquake modeling only. NERES is another EU-funded project, basically the equivalent of HAZUS to be developed here. And now NATO is developing a LIRA methodology to use there. So HAZUS is quickly being overcome by all these. Another one is the open risk. I'll talk about Agora later, but an open risk analysis program. I think most of us know this this curve. It comes from Munich Re, and it basically shows the bars are the losses here, and I think billions of dollars, U.S. billions, of various cats, as they call cats, disasters that have occurred historically. This dotted line is the increasing trend of losses. This is the insurance portion of that. So this is what the insurance industry is suffering, increasing losses. If we overlay on this all these developments I've talked about, what we see basically is that in parallel with all those developments is the development of computing power, mainframes, software going from free to proprietary, the PC being introduced here, GIS and GNU, the public open source concepts being introduced here, cat bonds coming in at this point, this is a growth of all of these, and then the various modelers being produced here. Koresh probably feels like his life is flashing before him, this slide. And so what we see, again, is the development of the assets, the hazard part of the equation, the vulnerability part of the equation, and finally the risk analysis methods. So this is basically your snapshot of the history of risk. Risk analysis from the point of view of natural hazards, and there are comparable developments in other fields such as environment, industrial safety, and so on. What's interesting is to observe at this point another trend that comes in, which is that starting in the 1960s, you start to see books like this, Life and Death of American Cities by Jane Jacobs, Unsafe Within the Speed by, about the automobile industry by Ralph Nader, Silent Spring about environmental hazards by Rachel Carson, and so on. And this is an increasing trend in concerns about risk. So while we have risk analysis methods developing as I've laid out, we also now start to have a greater consciousness of the, in this case, the American public through these publications, of risk concerns. And it's a kind of a watershed event. Basically, I would characterize the United States as risk-taking nation up until about the 1960s. And the publication of these books and others starts to show the change to a risk-averse nation. And Ulrich Beck, in 1980 publication, Risk Society, a book that's not well known in the United States, although it's very influential worldwide in the sociological field, talks about risk society, where he basically says, we've had a fundamental transition in society where we've been concerned with material shortages throughout our history, that is the distribution of goods, up until about this point in time. And now, at least in the developed nations, we're no longer interested in we're no longer chiefly concerned with the distribution of goods. We all have goods. What we're now interested in is the distribution of bads. that is the allocation of risk. And this has fundamental, what he has analyzed, fascinating, is the profound changes this makes in our attitudes towards each other and the changes in our society. And this is to some extent what I want to talk about from this point on. So now let's step back and look at some real catastrophes, because I've played a little trick with you. I've been calling these catastrophes because that's what people call them, the natural hazards, the earthquakes, and so on. But in reality, the last earthquake catastrophe was probably 1755 years ago. And certainly in modern times, in the 20th century, earthquakes have not been catastrophes, they've been disasters. We call them depression always too late. So let's look at 20th century deaths. In the 20th century, there have been about 4.1 billion people who have died. And of those 4.1 billion people, about 80% died more or less of what you might call natural causes. But what I mean is they more or less lived out their life expectancy for their society at that point. And about 20% of those people died prematurely from what we might call unnatural causes, including death and sickness, sickness in this, not all man-made causes. If we want to look at the breakdown of that 20%, which is about 800 million people, this shows the breakdown of the premature deaths. Now, the single largest cause here, does anybody want to venture a guess as to what the single largest cause of death in the 20th century has been? What? All right, thank you very much for your courage in volunteering that. Anybody else? I'm sorry? Okay, if there was someone.
Waterborne disease. So like diarrhea, things like that.
All right, anybody else?
Cigarettes.
That's not bad. Smoking's number two. Smallpox. And actually smallpox has been virtually eradicated about 1975. So smallpox really only had 75% batting chance here. Yet it still managed to cause about 500 million deaths out of the 800 million. Smoking is number two. And, I was going through Frankfurt Airport a few weeks ago and I walked by the duty free and there was an entire wall of cigarettes for sale. And from 50 feet away, I could see the big letters on these packages that said, kill. These cigarettes kill. It's amazing that people are still selling those things. World War II is, now of course this breakdown, we could discuss it. I mean, one, for example, is should Spanish influenza be included in World War I? But in any event, because the Spanish influenza was spread via World War I, but it's been broken out separately here. But you can see, first we have smallpox, then there's smoking, then the Second World War, Mao's regime here, influenza epidemic, pandemic in the Spanish flu in 1918-1919, and so on. And we go down here. And natural disasters account for roughly, depending on how you count it, whether you include smallpox or not, 0.5% to 1%, a very small fraction of that. Now, if we start to look at these events, at least a few of them, let's start to look at them. World War I, was described in 1903 by Erskine Childers, who is an interesting, fascinating character himself, in the book The Riddle of the Sands, which totally laid it out and basically profoundly influenced the development of the British naval strategy from 1903 up until World War I. 1923 earthquake was foretold by Imamura, as I mentioned. Omori, who had opposed Imamura in this when the earthquake happened, died within 4 months of that. World War II was accurately described by Bywater in 1925 book, including the Pearl Harbor attack. The book is called The Great Pacific War. He wrote it in 1925 and said it in 1931. This book, by the way, when it was published in 1925, was translated within months and used as a text in the Japanese War College. The China Syndrome, I think we all know. That nuclear power plant core meltdown was foreseen in the China Syndrome, in which the famous quote exists of render an area the size of Pennsylvania permanently uninhabitable. 13 days later, the Three Mile Island disaster happened. The fall of the Soviet Union It was basically foreseen by Kennan in his 1946 long telegram, which actually laid out the strategy of the Truman Doctrine of containment. In effect, not only was the fall of the Soviet Union foreseen, it was basically planned by Kennan in 1946, and so on. The World Trade Center 9/11, if you look at it, this is hardly an unpredictable disaster. I'm not going to show all the facts here, but basically, if you look at Wall Street has been a target of bombing going back almost 100 years. 1920, J.P. Morgan bombing here was killed about 100, which I think killed over 100 people. The Francis Tavern bombing of 1975, the 1993 first bombing of the Twin Towers, and then, of course, the attack on 9/11. These are the equivalents. This is the equivalent of a magnitude frequency relationship, so to speak. This is your TNT equivalents of all of these events occurring. You can see the increasing trend. In 1994, the Bojinka plot to blow up 11 airliners that were going to fly over the Pacific was thwarted by the Philippine authorities. 1994, at the same time, the Air France flight 8969 was hijacked with the intent to fly it into the Eiffel Tower. And in 1994, Tom Clancy's novel basically had a Boeing 747 flying directly into the U.S. Capitol building during a joint session of Congress with the fictional president attending and wiping out the entire, decapitating the United States. So all of these events were basically foreseen in various ways at that time. As a matter of fact, a lot of words here, but it's worth reading. It was a broiling, unfortunately, punchline comes in too. It was a broiling August afternoon in New Orleans, Louisiana. The next day, the storm gathered steam. More than a million people evacuated to high ground. Some 200,000 remained, however, the carless, the homeless, the aged, the infirm. The storm hit, pushing a deadly surge into Pontchartrain. The water poured in. A brown wall washed over the clapboard houses of the lower ninth, the ninth ward. People climbed on the roofs to escape. Thousands drowned. Thousands more survived, later perished from dehydration and disease. It took 2 months to pump the city dry, putrid sediment. It was the worst natural disaster, 50,000 dead. That's the only thing that's wrong in this paragraph. It was the worst natural disaster in the history of the United States. When did this calamity happen? It hasn't happened yet. The doomsday scenario was not far-fetched. This is the published in the lead paragraphs of the National Geographic article in October 2004. 11 months before Hurricane Katrina. Let's look at the present again, but let's look at a little bit different angle, perhaps. Most of us are earthquake people. We've all said it's not if, but when. Katrina was clearly foreseen. It's a name that should live in infamy in this country. The next San Francisco earthquake, is that going to be a disaster or a catastrophe? I mean, basically, we know it's coming. The city of San Francisco has paid for studies that lay out the risk by different parts of the city. Matter of fact, if they want to, they could lay out the risk building by building, and yet the study hasn't been published. In Japan, on the other hand, so the technology is there. It's that modeling technology we've seen. Japan has laid out in newspapers here that what the different faults would do in the Kansai region, similar maps for Tokyo, 42,000 here, for example, in Osaka. Shame. These events should not be. Katrina should not have happened. The coming San Francisco earthquake should not be a great disaster. This Japanese earthquake that are going to happen should not be the greatest great disasters. The point I'm making is that some of these events that we call disasters or catastrophes, some of them are foreseeable. Some of them are foreseen. Some of them are foretold. And some of them are even predicted, although prediction only came to assume the scientific sense of having a producible consequence. It was only reported in that sense from 1961. But all these words imply increasing precision. And in general, we're not yet quite predicting, in terms of a window of time, when these things are going to occur. But we're certainly foretelling, if not, we're certainly foreseeing, if not foretelling, when they're going to occur. And these are disasters, and these are catastrophes. Catastrophes are disasters that are unforeseen and so profound, they make so profound a change as to change our place in the world, our view of the world. They are a paradigm shift. Foreseeable disasters are the next San Francisco earthquake, the next Tokyo earthquake, the next Asian mega earthquake, maybe foreseeable. This is Billum's map of the Himalayan front. This shows the Pakistan earthquake of 2005, the Kashmir earthquake. This shows, that's the 7.6, this shows the comparable, to a comparable scale, seismic gaps that exist along that front. And each of these black dots represents cities of 1 million to 10 million people along the Indo-Gangetic plain. So probably the next Asian mega earthquake is foreseeable. Is the next economic depression analogous to 1925 foreseeable? I don't know, we may be experiencing it. Is Asian flu, the comparable to the Spanish flu, the avian flu, foreseeable? I think so. Global warming? Well, the IPCC has told us, and the CERN report told us what's going to be happening now. So what's not foreseeable? The 1755 Lisbon earthquake was not foreseeable. That was a profound change in Western Europe. 1917 Spanish flu was not foreseen. And I think that that was probably a true catastrophe, certainly not the deaths of us. The 1929 crash and the Great Depression, this, I think, also made a profound change in American history and American culture. It's a paradigm shift. The 2004 tsunami, well, maybe not in Sumatra, where it did most of its damage, killing 125,000 people in Banda Aceh, but they knew they had earthquake damage, or earthquake risk there. But Sri Lanka, they had no conception that something like that could happen to them. So these kinds of, now, these kinds of things are, people are thinking about these. This is a report put out basically by the World Economic Forum, and it shows people thinking about the fundamental catastrophic risks that might affect the globe. With increasing, you can see here from varying degrees of likelihood and varying degrees of severity in terms of billions going to trillions of dollars. And I won't go through all of them, but there's natural catastrophes here, oil price shock, fall in the US dollar, pandemics, and so on. But in most cases, most of these could actually be very, rather well foreseen. I mean, the newspapers every day are full of talk about the fall in the dollar. So these are disasters. They're foreseeable. Remind you of the scientific revolutions and paradigm shift. Kuhn in 1962 wrote this book and he pointed out that fundamentally the paradigm shift is when events are do not fit our existing models. The research where we've been trying to put things into conceptual boxes no longer fit the new data we have. As a result, we have to make a new change. One of the classic examples of this is the shift from Newtonian mechanics to quantum mechanics, because what Bohr and others were observing in the atom could no longer be explained by Newtonian mechanics. And what I'm suggesting analogously is that catastrophes are anomalous disasters that subvert our existing assumptions and traditions with regard to safety. So how do we? So if this is the case, and we basically these are unknown, how do we know the unknown? If we're going to be really concerned with catastrophic risk, how do we know the unknown? Well, Colin Wilson, who's one of the original Angry Young Men of England, and the author of The Outsider, wrote a book in '62 called The Strength of the Dream, in which he looked at authors and so on, and he basically. It's an interesting book. It made the point that powerhouse exists in the subconscious regions of the mind. We call that imagination. It's closely imagination, and he looked at all these different authors and so on. It's closely bound up with our sense of value. The author's meaning, the author's ideas are the meaning and the purpose of existence. And the artist, in exploring these questions, explores the unknown. And as I showed you previously, Clancy, I'm not sure I'd call him an artist, but the author Clancy and Bywater and Erskine Childers, who was an artist, have all basically were looking into the future. They were using their imagination and foretelling what foreseeing and foretelling true catastrophes. So cat risk is not what's expected, but rather the unknown and disastrous, with an emphasis on both. Unknown cats the true cat risk means managing, so unknown cats, in managing that, we have to manage the unknown, which seems strange. We have to think outside the box. The next San Francisco earthquake, no matter how catastrophic it will be, sorry, I put my words there. The next San Francisco earthquake, no matter how disastrous it will not be a catastrophe unless it destroys in major unforeseen ways. The fire in 1906 was foreseen in 1905. We know it's coming, and we even believe we know what it will do. And actually, a fair degree of preparedness has been done here to people's part. So how do we assess the unknown? How to dream, going back to Colin Wilson's point. We can't just randomly wander about. You want to take a clue from the military. The military doctrine says base your planning not on your enemy's intentions, because you can't know their intentions, but your enemy's capabilities, that is, vis-a-vis your own vulnerabilities. So we need to look at our own vulnerabilities. Global warming is one of the vulnerabilities. I don't know. There are a number of climate change skeptics around, so it may not be so bad, really. I mean, what's a couple of degrees? All right, maybe we'll be growing grapes a few miles further north or whatever, but it's not so bad, really, right? Well, global warming could result in what's called the thermohaline circulation disruption, which would have a profound effect on climates. I'm not sure if you're familiar with this, but the thermohaline is basically, we all know what the Gulf Current is. The Gulf Current is actually just a part of a flow of water that circles the oceans, the ocean basins of the world. Basically, you have a flow of water that, depending on where you want to start it, starting in Greenland here, it comes up, it plunges at this point, goes down, and is cold, and goes up here, and then comes back to the surface, comes down along here, and goes back through the Gulf Current here, and so on like that. With global warming, the melting of the Greenland Glacier ice cap would introduce a massive flood of fresh water at this point and could actually totally change this pattern, disrupt the flow of water, which would have a profound change. It would make Western Europe much, much colder. It would disrupt climates around the world. So that's an example, I think, of a potentially unforeseen catastrophe. Let's look at one that might be intentional. Let's look at cyber war and communications. Consider that in 2007, Estonia had cyber attacks. I'm not sure if you're familiar with that, but Estonia is a former Soviet colony. It had a legacy statue of a soldier as a war memorial. For whatever reason, I don't know the details, the Estonians decided to remove that statue. The Russian, at least some people in Russia, well, the Russian government protested, and some people in Russia felt that many Russians had died to liberate Estonia, so that this monument should be honored and consecrated and not removed. Estonians removed it, and within days, there was a massive cyber denial service attack on the nation of Estonia, which they actually successfully resisted, and it all came out of, the cyber attack came out of Russia. Russian government denied any responsibility, but it's a small example of a disruption to infrastructure. Consider that combined with the 2001 U.S. postal anthrax attacks, which have never been explained. Now, you just take these two and scale these two things up. If you had simultaneously an attack on the U.S. infrastructure networks with loss of telecom, power, and the internet, and even perhaps broadcast, and an introduction of larger scale anthrax attacks on the postal system, UPS, DHL, and FedEx systems. How are we going to communicate? Let's look at the US dollar. This is the plot since about 1970 of the US dollar. This is when it had an unusual spike when interest rates were raised in the early 80s. As we all know, I think the US dollar is at a historic low at the moment. This continues, there's going to be a shift away from the dollar as a reserve currency. If at the same time we had a Tokyo earthquake, which is going to be about $1 trillion hit, it's probably the largest foreseeable disaster, natural disaster from an economic point of view that could happen. Japan may wind up selling massive dollar reserves. At that point, it becomes a fire sale. China jumps in and sells dollars either due to the panic or perhaps out of strategic reasons. And if so, we then have a major drop in the US dollar. I mean, we're talking right now, the dollar is down 40%. I'm talking here, the people have the dollar down 80%. Maybe not permanently, maybe only for a few years, but until enough foreigners rush in and buy the Rockefeller Center again and the golf links and so on. But this would result in a major hike in interest rates and a major recession or depression. This would be a catastrophe. It's almost foreseeable. Next one is even more unusual. This book is a book published. Anybody heard of this book, Unrestricted Warfare? Has anybody heard of this book? Unrestricted Warfare literally is translated from the Chinese as Warfare Beyond Bounds. It's a 1999 book written by two PRC, People's Republic of China, PLA, People's Liberation Army colonels. It was China's army colonels. They wrote it in 1999. It asks the question, or addresses the question, how can a nation, for example China, defeat a technologically superior opponent such as the US? And the answer is embodied in the question. The US basically looks at warfare as a technology competition. So therefore, you don't want to try to compete technologically. You don't want to have a direct military confrontation. Rather, you want to use other means, such as what's called lawfare, economic means, network attacks, and terrorism. Now, lawfare, an example of lawfare would be the Kyoto Protocol. Kyoto Protocol, for example, calls for a reduction in U.S. Greenhouse gas emissions of 6% between 2008 and 2012, while it allows China to increase gas house emissions by 54% in that period. Economic means, piracy of intellectual property such as software and DVDs, patent warfare, network attacks would be infrastructure attacks, terrorism. Well, I think we're all familiar with that term today. These are the 1990 to 2004, the U.S. greenhouse gas emissions increased 16% during this period, and the Kyoto Protocol goals for this period are to reduce these by, it should be 8%. Japan's have increased by 6%, the goal is reduced by 6%. The EU's were basically flat, they did not increase greenhouse emissions during this period, and their EU goals reduced it by 8%. China's increased by 47% during this period, and the goal, the Kyoto Protocol has no requirement for them to decrease their emissions. India increased by 55% during this period. And admittedly, China and India's greenhouse gas emissions are increasing percentage-wise from a much lower base. So this is not quite as unfair as it may seem. But still, this is an example of lawfare in this regard, using the law to accomplish what you might accomplish by military means, but by other means. So, now, I mention this because it just, when I saw this, it was very interesting to me. Since 1999, has China been pursuing a policy of not direct military confrontation, but in effect, warfare by other means against the United States? I don't know. I just know that since 1999, the US position has eroded in all different ways in the world. I don't blame it on the Chinese. I don't know what the cause is exactly, but I know I can tell you the position has eroded economically and in every other way in the world. All right, so what do we do about this? Well, one thing is I'll offer you a small thing that I'm trying to do about this, and that is, what I'm involved in, a number of other people are involved in, comes out of a confluence of two different influences. One is the whole natural hazards thing I've talked about, kind of risk analysis and so on. The other one is the open source software movement. The confluence of these two things has resulted in something called the Alliance for Global Open Risk Analysis, AGORA. AGORA, as we all know, is a Greek word, means an open place where people meet. In this case, it's an international forum contributing to reducing natural hazards, death, and destruction through open risk modeling. This is a picture of the Greek Athenian arbor. Open doesn't mean free in this case. It means the antonym of closed. What I mean by that is that AGRA stands for fostering open methods, open tools, and open data. And I'm mentioning this because if we're going to counteract disasters and catastrophes, we have to provide the tools. And the hazards, for example, is a good tool, but it's not openly available in the sense of being able to get in and understand it and change it to suit our needs. It's not nimble. If you want changes in hazards, it takes a long time. I don't mean to pick on hazards, but it's an example. It's one of the few programs that's freely distributed and deserving of praise in that regard. But if we had tools that were more open, that would increase people's acceptance and utilization, not only in the United States, but around the world. So AGRA has been formed to do this globally. There was a meeting in 2007 that created it. Examples of some of the things that are happening are, I think you're probably familiar with Ned Field's work in open seismic hazard analysis, the open seas development. Here, these address the hazard part of the equation, the vulnerability part of the equation. What's been missing so far is a risk engine to tie these together. AGRA is now trying to develop open risk analysis. There's been some, the AGRA website has a complete architecture for doing this. You can go to that website. There's some of the software that's been developed. These are all open source codes. At Kyoto University, we've developed an open source risk engine that basically allows computation for any hazard curve, any vulnerability curve, of loss exceedance curve with confidence bounds. The World Bank has promoted the development of MyRisk, which is basically a global hazard database, exposure attributes, and allows a certain amount of benefit cost analysis. And hopefully the bank will be distributing this for use around the world. Virtual clearinghouse has been developed on a test basis as a test bed. It has over a thousand pictures of photographs from the Pakistan earthquake. AGRA's promoting this also as an example of this data that's available there. The Japanese are promoting something like disaster reduction hyperbase. I'll be glad to hear you on this one. So AGRA is an example, is an effort to try to sort of deal with some of these catastrophic risk potentials by putting taking the culmination of 150 years of work by many people and putting it in the hands of many more users in an open, free format. And it's been being promoted on one of these occasions. So with that then, let me conclude by just talking about CATs in the future. CATs catastrophes, by definition, the way I've defined significantly unknown in time and space and their impacts. Time is can be our friend and our enemy. What do I mean by that? Well, with time, trees grow apples, but the storms come and destroy those trees. Money bears interest, but money may lose value. So imagine the future means not being blind, in fact, actually seeing the possibilities, both positive and negative. If we are to manage catastrophic risk, we must envision the possibilities of the true catastrophes of the future, envision and Colin Wilson's sense of the word, use our imagination and assess their impacts. And with that, I know this sounds like the history of the world, or maybe it's including part two, or maybe it sounded like War and Peace. But with that, I thought of calling this Cats and Dogma. But with that, then I simply want to thank you and hope that none of us are ever in this situation again. Thank you very much.
That one pie chart you had that talked about kind of the loss of life and so on.
Sure. Yeah, well, one of my colleagues in Japan had to teach a course on emergency planning and asked me, what's the difference between an emergency and a disaster? And I thought for a second, and I told him, well, if your wife calls you up and says she's going to be late to get home and there's not going to be any dinner, that's an emergency. But if she tells you she's got, the reason she's late is because she had an accident in the car, that's a disaster. So, catastrophe and disaster are really functions of who bears the loss. And so, Stalin had a terrible quote, one death is a tragedy, a million deaths is a statistic. Of course, he wasn't bearing those stats. The 3.4 million people that have died due to natural hazards in the 20th century, those were sudden events. And in a sense, not predictive. And they are something that can be relatively easily rectified with knowledge that we have. This is some of the reasons that people dwell on this problem, Most of those deaths were due to, after smallpox, which the medical profession has time to cure. Smoking, which they haven't, although maybe it's not their job, it's somebody else's job. Many of those were conflict things, and those are maybe much more difficult problems to solve. The other part of the issue is, where are natural hazards really being mitigated? And I'm generalizing here, but they're mitigated where people have disposable income to mitigate. So these are some of the reasons why. In the Bay Area, where people don't want to suffer a disaster, they can see it coming. So we spend over $30 billion in the Bay Area to reduce natural hazards. $3 billion in bridge alone, I think, to reduce natural hazards. So is that where students should be dedicating their life? As opposed to, say, a smallpox or smoking or something like that. That's a personal decision. But I think we attack it because maybe it's some place where we feel we can make an impact. Yes, sir.
I was confused by your use of the really so bad question mark in your slide about leading into your discussion about global warming. I'm familiar with that macro water flow issue, but I wasn't sure whether you were speaking for yourself or some of the very, very small number of skeptics, many of whom make a lot of noise but are a very marginal qualification to speak on the subject, as I'm sure you know. I'm wondering if you personally would amplify on your concern, because the notion of waving your hands and saying, what's a couple of degrees, is, in my opinion, very seriously misleading about the implications of this.
Yeah, what I was simply trying to say is that there are skeptics out there.
Yeah, they get way more credit for their position than they remotely deserve. In my opinion.
Yeah, I'm not sure how much credit they get. But I think, why didn't the U.S. sign the Kyoto Protocol? I mean, there's different reasons for that. I think skepticism was one of those. So I think there's been a lot more skepticism. I think times have changed. Since the Stern Report came out, Gore's position has ascended and so on. I think there's been a fundamental change here. It's taken the United States a lot longer than the rest of the world to wake up. And there's been a lot more, maybe, skepticism, including some of our leadership, in regard to this until very recently. That was not my personal position. Maybe I've been waking up too, to be fair. But I was trying to say that 1 or 2 degrees change over decades may not seem so bad to some people, but actually, you can have a very rapid climate change very quickly if you get that thermal haline disruption, and This is not a gradual onset over a protracted period of time where we can adapt. That's one of my points. This could be a catastrophic event in a sudden onset term. That was the point I was trying to make. So I was not trying to say that climate change is not a serious concern. If that was your concern, you thought I was saying that.
A catastrophe would be an earthquake in a major city, but that's still very local. It doesn't threaten the global population of species.
That was the other point I was making. I think that, you know, disaster and catastrophe is a matter of personal definition in both cases. And if your car is destroyed, it's a personal catastrophe. Your house is ruined. But what I'm trying to look at is from a societal point of view. And I was trying to draw the distinction between, because when I started thinking about catastrophic risk, you know, I was confused, disasters and catastrophes, well, this synonymous. And I don't mean to just focus on the semantics of two words. But the fundamental message I was trying to make, if I didn't make it clear before, I'll make it clear now, is simply that disasters are things that we know are coming, and we're going to deal with them. And we want to talk about catastrophic risk, I'm keying over that word. These are things that we generally are blindsided by. So how are we going to deal with that? How are we going to manage that risk? And the way to use it is what I showed you from the literature, that artists, are people who dwell down and deep inside, and when they're understanding, when they're concerned about the value of society and the meaning, they see things because they're looking that the rest of us don't see. And if we choose to, we can see the potential for these catastrophic risks. I gave you a couple of examples, the crash of the dollar, the thermohaline disruption, and this Chinese attack. I don't mean to malign the Chinese, but they did write a book about this.
I was just curious about where you think this agora is going.
Maybe I'm not using my imagination. right now we had the meeting and people paid their own money to come in around the world to attend the meeting. It was a modest meeting, it had a few dozen people. ATC supported it. Craig Tolman was one of our speakers. A number of people in California were very supportive of it. I think we need more people involved. I think that at the moment the leadership is very dispersed around the globe, and there's not much activity. There's not much activity happening, and it could be a still more event. I think that many more people, Keith Porter and myself, perhaps two people putting most energy into it, and we don't have a huge budget of energy. I don't mean money. We need more people involved, we haven't even done a lot of recruiting. Websites there, people want to jump on it. I'd love to have you involved. As a matter of fact, if you want to take over any aspect of it, let me go. I'm not trying to get rid of it, but maybe I didn't fully answer your question. I'm telling you. Where do I think it's going to go? I think it's going to go one of two ways. It's either going to be stillborn or it's going to take off. And the whole point is that Agora is born out of the frustration of not having open risk analysis. And in preparing this talk, I thought about it. I thought, catastrophic risk, how do we manage it? Well, if you put the tools out, it came back to the same motivation. If you put the tools out there, build a new economy. And that's where I'd like to see it go. You asked me where I think it's going to go. That's a different question. And I don't know the answer. I hope that answers your question. Yeah?
What can we in this room as scientists and engineers do to address catastrophes since we're so accustomed to addressing disasters?
Join Agora.
But does
No, what it addresses is open risk analysis. What it basically says is that if you want to reduce death and destruction, you need to approach it in a rational way. And right now, the tools for doing that are not available. So this is an organization to try and promote those tools. That's what Ogden does. And those tools, which if they're out there, can be freely used by people, they themselves, you know, it's the invisible hand, they themselves, invisible hand is an analogy to the marketplace, they themselves will make their own informed decisions. But to come back to your question, what can people in this room do with regard to catastrophes? I think, basically, try to analyze how you can be blindsided. That sounds weird. But the way you go about doing it is basically look at what assets do you have to lose. And assets are, you know, your individual assets and your collective assets, our society. What do we have to lose? And then how do we go about protecting those assets? And those assets are a matter of personal definition. One person will think globally. And assets are, you know, human life around the world and so on. Another person may think much more selfishly. But I think that's so. I could go on. Can I answer your question? I mean, if you want me to give you a list of specific things to do tomorrow morning, I'll see you later. Well, this community is, if you're talking about the Bay Area, I think Bay Area is probably the best prepared place in the world, although it's still ill prepared. So when you say we're not doing a good job, we spent over $30 billion in Bay Area to protect 6 million people. So that's a $5,000 that's been spent in about the last 15 years. And actually, that's an underestimate. That's what we've been able to. That was what ERI, Northern California Chapter, was able to total. And it's mostly public expenditures, not private. I think you need to do it. Well, first of all, disasters are foreseeable, and therefore they simply ought to be managed. But if you don't also spend a bit of your time considering things outside the box, things that could blindside you, catastrophe. Then if you don't at least consider those and in some way try to protect yourself against those, you're going to be blindsided. Or we're going to be blindsided. There's an example I got out of a book recently called The Black Swan, which kind of talks about this topic. He talks about Las Vegas casinos. And he says, where do you think the risk is? Well, it's not on the tables. I mean, they've got that nailed. They know exactly to the penny how much they get to rake in every day. Not that they're cheating, but they know the odds on the tables, and there's lots of tables, so the volatility between tables is very low. But Siegfried and Roy were one of their performers, and when one of them got mauled by the tiger and had to cancel the show, they lost $100 million in ticket sales, which they weren't insured for. Now, that was a risk at that casino. So, you know, the risk manager might have thought about that. The risk is not on the table. Similarly, Harrah's, when it got blown up a few, 10, 15 years ago, probably, I'm not. That's a risk. So I think you need a prudent person who does both. And how do you go about it? You can run all over the world trying to think of, or drive yourself nuts trying to think of everything, you know, meteors and everything else. Well, the key to it is to, I think the key to it is, one, what are your assets? Because that's the military doctrine, not what are the capabilities, but what are the, not what are the intentions, what are the capabilities, what are your vulnerabilities, what are your assets at risk? And then the second one is, let your mind wander. Think outside the box.
Thank you.
is.
Yes, I agree. I mean, 10 years ago, there was almost zero, no simulation. So this boomed in the past 10 to 5 years, 5 years, literally. So we learn as we go for CFD applications for indoor airflow simulations. I'm not talking about other applications.
But have those models, the CFD models, been tested for sensitivity to material parameters? Because sometimes these models are sensitive to material parameters. You change the material parameter a little bit, then you change the results considerably.
Yes, are you talking about air properties or like species concentration or which?
Either one.
The answer is I'm not familiar with the testing of parameters change on the simulation accuracy. We still use just 1.2 kilograms per air density. We assume that species concentrations are similar. I agree with you that needs to be tested.
Based on your modeling analyses, what are your most or least favorite kinds of forced ventilation systems?
My favorite forced ventilation system is natural.
I mean, have you seen significant differences in either thermal comfort or air quality as a function of the type of forced ventilation system?
Air quality is tends to be better with the displacement ventilation. So that's the system that I would prefer to have in my office if I had a choice.
Anything else?
Yeah, one interesting application I think of green buildings is in schools, so like elementary schools, high schools, and things like that have, I guess, what are the opportunities for using this to improve designs for schools to actually help kids learn better?
That's a great topic. Because somehow, again, as I told to some of you, the younger generation get better than my generation. Kids are really excited. I receive emails on a regular basis from primary school kids asking me to bring the green roof samples. And in fact, that's exactly what we will be doing in terms of the learning education. In fact, there are also studies that are confirming that children have a better attention span and better learning curves living and working in green building schools, published, available, I mean, initial kind of results, but I don't think it's far-fetched.
No more questions. Okay, let's thank the speaker again.